again.
Good job. It was a very interesting flight, one I'd never make again.
But Ben and Maxie did try again, heading across the Atlantic on August 11th, 1978, joined by a third man, Larry Newman.
Double Eagle 2, this is Bob Beatty. Things look like they're going great.
It's Tuesday, the 15th.
Today is Wednesday, isn't it?
Tuesday, the 15th, 10 o'clock Zulu.
And Double Eagle, this is King 5-0. For your information, the present way you've been tracking for the past few hours will take you into the Irish coast between Shannon and Limerick.
Double Eagle, this is Bob Beatty. Can you hear me?
No, this is Double Eagle. This is Ben.
Ben, it's nice to talk to you. How's everything going up here?
Well, considering everything, actually quite well. It's a little cold, got a long way to go, but ballast lets us go through tonight, and we land tomorrow with reasonable ballast. If we make our destination, should be okay. If we don't, we land in the sea.
Sports Special, The Spirit of 78, the flight of Double Eagle 2.
Hello, I'm Bob Beatty, standing in a clover field just outside of Presque Isle, Maine. And I'll tell you one thing, this clover field will never be the same because behind me is the Double Eagle 2 from Albuquerque, New Mexico.
The flight is piloted by Ben Abruzzo and Maxie Anderson, veterans of one previous attempt to cross the Atlantic, and Larry Newman, who hopes to fly off in a hang glider for a personal landing in Europe.
They plan to leave at 6. But the inflation drags on. The year before, they had the largest helium balloon ever. But this one, at 160,000 cubic feet, is almost 60% larger. Now the entire flight can be jeopardized by the delay.
We told them how big the balloon was, told them to bring more than enough to fill it, and they brought apparently just 162,000, we're 160, so if they were light, we won't get a full load. Shortens the trip. We'd have to take off slack. It would be a different kind of flight. Slightly different. The front end of it would be different. And the longevity would be reduced.
We've got 20% to go on the balloon. So it may take us a long time, but we ought to be able to come very close.
It'll take an hour. An hour? It's terrific. Just terrific.
On the night of August 11th, the clover field in Presque Isle, Maine becomes an eerie scene of waiting and expectation. Double Eagle 2, its black and silver nylon rising 11 stories high, poised to set off on the journey, even though history says the Atlantic cannot be conquered. For Larry Newman, sailing off at the end of the flight is a goal that's possible only if the impossible itself is achieved. For the two veteran balloonists, Ben Abruzzo and Maxie Anderson, the moment has come. This time for one more goodbye. And now balloon designer Ed Yost slowly and evenly removes the ballast that still holds them on the North American continent. Pat Abruzzo and Patty Anderson can only wait and watch along with the rest of the crowd. For them and everyone else, the reality of this incredible journey is finally here and now. 8:42 p.m. and liftoff. The flight of Double Eagle 2, the 18th attempt to cross the Atlantic, has begun. And now, like Lindbergh, more than 3,000 miles of lonely air and mostly vast ocean await them. But there's trouble right away. The balloon hits a pocket of warm air and dips sharply down. Suddenly, they recover. The agonizing drop is over and they begin to climb. It's farewell to Presque Isle, Maine, by a margin so thin that the odds of success now seem overwhelming. Early the next morning over Canada, the team prepares their navigational antenna.
You didn't do Mr. Tapefinger. You know, Mr. Goldfinger didn't Tapefinger.
team will be communicating by radio to the Weather Command Center in Bedford, Massachusetts, as well as to aircraft and ships.
Did he say to tie that on to our vector?
You ready to turn on the leaking switch to see if we had a good signal?
Okay, we've got it now. Okay.
You got the safety line?
Yeah.
Take the safety line, let me get the hose away.
Go ahead. I got them both still. Just barely over the edge. That's okay. That's good right there. Okay.
I got you. Let me safety it.
It seems like I shampoo and shampoo and shampoo,
but I just can't keep ahead of the greasies.
That's why I suggest New Agree Shampoo. It works two ways to help stop the greasies between shampoos. First, Agree cleans your hair, and then it gently cleans your scalp, where the greasies can start.
So your hair stays cleaner between shampoos.
It's true. My hair stays cleaner longer and looks terrific longer.
New Agree Shampoo. It helps stop the greasies between shampoos.
I went to Albuquerque for a flight with Maxie and Ben in a hot air balloon.
That when a balloon goes through the air, that it's actually flying. However, it's been explained to me by you and Maxie that, really the balloon is not flying at all. It's the air mass that's taking it along. Could you explain a little bit more about that?
It's as if we're a particle in an air mass, just like a feather. And we're moving with that air mass, so there's no relative airspeed whatsoever. Therefore, as we go along, we have no sensation of movement if we can't see anything that that we can make a relationship to, like the ground. So when we're out over the Atlantic, it's as if there's no movement and there's precisely no sound. You can take a handkerchief, for instance, and place it, or a map or your chart, and place it on the rail, and it'll just stay there for hours. Unless we change the altitude, significant change, a quick change, your chart will remain wherever you place it. No movement whatsoever, no sound. Absolutely serene.
I hate to ask this question, but without oxygen, or with a malfunction in your oxygen, how long would you last at 25,000 feet?
At 25,000, you pass out in about anywhere from 1 to 4 minutes, depending on the physical condition and what you're used to altitude-wise. You will regain consciousness if you go down. If you stay up at that altitude, you won't regain consciousness and you'll be dead. So if you pass out and one of us is sleeping, one of the other crew has got to get his oxygen system going, give him his supply temporarily, or we have to go down. We have no choice at that altitude.
Maxie, what's the difference between a hot air balloon like the one that we're in right now and a helium balloon that you'll be going across the Atlantic in?
Well, the hot air depends upon heat being heating the air so that the air inside of the balloon is lighter and hotter than the air on the outside. Whereas in a helium balloon, the lift is the helium itself, which is much lighter than air, and the air it displaces gives you lift to lift weight off of the ground, such as the gondola and men.
Plus that the helium is pretty expensive to fill a balloon with, isn't it?
On the flight coming up, it's about $9,000.
Ben, what's the sensation of flying across the Atlantic in a balloon?
Well, it's got to be one of the most unique adventures I think any man could experience. Starting out to tackle a 3,000-mile journey, one that's never been made, one that's been attempted for over a century, and there have been approximately 18 attempts to cross the Atlantic. Gives you a feeling of exhilaration and one of great accomplishment, assuming that you make it. Now, last year when we landed in Iceland, we still felt a sense of accomplishment, of course.
Let's hope this is a successful one.
Thank you.
Still heading over Newfoundland on the first day of the journey, Double Eagle 2 has radio problems. Even worse, they can't seem to get above 4,000 feet to the 10,000-foot level they would like. As I talk to them from our jet, they still seem calm.
Larry, this is Bob Beatty speaking to you. You've been out about 15 hours now. How's everything going?
Well, we got a lot of our communication problems solved. Our only apparent concern right now is that the balloon continues to descend, and it is necessary to ballast off precious weight in order to maintain altitude.
Now, you say the balloon's descending. Does that mean you might have a leak in the balloon?
Well, we don't think so. We've just finished looking up inside of the balloon itself, and we see no holes. But for some strange reason, the balloon is descending, which is contrary to the way the balloon would operate in the heat of the day.
Okay, now, after 15 hours, how far have you come?
That's a good question.
So in other words, you're having a fairly slow route right now, right?
That's correct. The flight is progressing very slow. The last 3 hours, our wind has picked up to approximately 20 knots, but we can't achieve the altitude which we would like, which is 10,000 feet, because of this apparent descent problem.
Well, we're going to be keeping track of you to see if that's taken care of. In the meantime, did anybody get any sleep last night?
Yes, Ben and Maxie both took a short rest period. The sleeping quarters are very comfortable and very warm inside. Because this is my first balloon trip, of course, I'm a little excited, so I didn't sleep last night, but in the next hour or so, I'll take my rest period.
Well, you seem to have some beautiful weather. All in all, do the three of you feel that the trip is going along as well as you'd hoped?
Actually, it's not progressing quite as well as we would like. We're not really sure why we're descending, which of course is a baffling problem, and we've been plagued with some radio problems, so things could be better, but we'll just have to see.
What kind of radio problems have you had?
Well, we seem to have two faulty antennas on two different radios.
Okay, well, we'll be keeping track of you.
The gondola was put together in Larry Newman's factory. Built to carry over 4,000 pounds of ballast and equipment, it's designed to float in the water.
What have you tried to accomplish, though, with the design?
What we have here is essentially a small sailboat. It's a catamaran design, one that's been tested and proven, and is essentially capable of sailing across the Atlantic.
You know, it doesn't seem to me that it'd be very shipworthy in 25-foot waves. What was it like last year?
Scared hell out of you.
Excuse me just standing here, can I tell you?
Actually, the water looked so high above us that if one of those waves broke on us, we'd have been filled up in about 1/10 of a second, I expect.
So you have a pump in here to pump some of the water out?
Two bilge pumps in the stern, and they work very well.
Ben, how about the colors? What's the significance of those?
Bob, the yellow, which is the upper color, is for visibility from the air. The red, if the gondola is turned over, and this is a situation where we would land on, say, Greenland or on the polar ice, which we almost did the last time, turned upside down, this essentially forms a small igloo, and the red is the best color for being visible to white background.
Well, let's take a look at these rain flaps and pull these down and see what happens there.
All right.
The rain flaps when we fly will normally stay up. They'll be secured to the load ring, which this is a dummy load ring, so it's similar to the actual ring on the balloon. And if it starts to rain, we lower these down. We zip them up, and hopefully it'll be nice and cozy inside.
Notice I'm helping you now, but I'm not going to
be... You do such a good job.
This is the last time you're going to see me.
We think you should maybe come with us on this flight, help us put these covers down.
How many hours of rain did you have on your last trip?
About 40 hours of rain.
40 hours of rain?
Yes, and this time I'm also bringing my umbrella.
trusting this completely, Max. Well, it certainly looks interesting. Let's take a look at it in the water.
Sounds like a good idea. Good plan.
They practice sailing on a lake in New Mexico just in case.
We're heading due east right into the sun that's just coming up. We're about 90 miles west of St. John. Our last position fix during the night turned out to be right on the money based on our actual this morning. Communications are good. Systems are all go. The balloon looks good. We're starting to pick up a little convection heat from the earth here, although there's an awful lot of water, and getting a little bit of lift out of it already.
Well, what do you think we're going to go up to today?
I think we'll go 10 for sure, and then we may have to ballast the rest of the way up to a little higher altitude if control thinks we ought to go up.
In Minnesota, we were on hand for the sole test inflation of this giant balloon. It was inspected for leaks and painted. Balloon designer Ed Yost helped create both the Double Eagles and also holds the record for time and distance in a balloon. We asked him what made the Double Eagle 2 different from the original.
Well, basically, this flight is similar to last year's, except the balloon is 60,000 cubic feet larger, so that they can climb to a higher altitude and take advantage of winds if they'd like to. We also have a capability of this time, the first time we've made one of these balloons, in the ocean crossing balloon, we can open the hole up in the appendix, and like they're floating at 30,000 feet, they want to come down and float at 15,000 feet. We have two holes they can open up, and the balloon will descend and seek a new floating altitude. This is quite a unique thing. You know, we've been doing it 28 years, and we've learned a lot along the way, I hope, and we incorporate everything we've learned throughout the years into this machine. Okay?
Direction's good. It appears as though our forecast and our track, our speed, everything is checking out. We're averaging about 20 knots. We're coming up on St. John's in about 3 hours.
Hey, Ben, check the water for me, please. Let's see how breakfast is, okay? Delightful.
Ew.
Get my coffee.
I'm standing on Signal Hill overlooking St. John's, Newfoundland, where right behind me the Double Eagle 2 is making excellent progress and about to move right over the Atlantic Ocean. Well, they've been in the air almost 36 hours now. They've come about 825 miles. They're at an altitude of 10,000 feet, and they're moving at about 35 miles an hour, which is almost twice as fast as they were moving yesterday. This means the winds are picking up, and everything looks very good at this point. Well, St. John's is the oldest city in North America. It's also the city farthest east, and from here on, it's the Atlantic Ocean all the way to Europe. Also, in 1901, Marconi stood where I'm standing right now and received the first wireless message from Europe. More significant is the fact that Lindbergh in 1927 flew the Spirit of St. Louis right overhead on his way to make his successful solo flight to Europe. So, Double Eagle 2, having no control over exactly where they're going because they're really at the mercy of the wind, is having the luck of taking practically the same route. Let's see if we can talk to the crew. Gentlemen, how's everything looking up there?
Which is another 100 hours at this speed. If we were to pick up the winds that we expect, we could be like 60, 70 hours, which is what we had the flight planned for. However, in general,
Okay, in talking to the flight center in Bedford, they wanted to relay the fact that you're about 10,000 feet now and probably should go up to around 20,000 by tomorrow.
We may get up to 15 by tomorrow, 15,000. That will probably be 20,000 the next day.
How about the ballast? Do you still have plenty? How's the food up there? What'd you have for dinner?
Hot dogs a la Maxie Anderson. And then for breakfast, we had donuts a la Newman. And for lunch, we had tuna fish, sardines, and chunk turkey a la Abruzzo.
Sounds like a real gourmet experience. Well, we'll be checking in a little bit later. Good luck to you.
What do you say we try to get me in the hang glider?
Let's do it.
Okay.
In Albuquerque before the flight, Larry Newman practiced getting down to the hang glider from the gondola. If the balloon does make it across the ocean, and if the glider isn't dropped off because of weight, he'd have his chance over Europe. But it's one more precarious venture that needs some practice.
This same rotation takes place all the time we're flying.
Yes?
Yeah. Slowly, though, very slowly.
All right.
I'll just keep tension on you.
Okay. Is that it?
No.
Let me down.
I'm just walking you off easy. You're all the way. except for this little slack, Larry.
It's okay, I'm where I need to be.
Okay, you got 6 inches of slack here is all. Go ahead.
Well, here I come, Europe.
Ben and Maxie took Larry up in a hot air balloon for his first attempt at a release of the glider. Larry felt that he had a 20% chance of stalling out. Hang gliding off the first balloon to cross the Atlantic would be just icing on the cake. The experience made him dizzy and nauseous. But the glider released and he was off, knowing it could be done.
We're coming up through 14.5 now.
We ought to check also. Let's go to 100% and see that we got it both on normal and 100%, okay?
On board the Double Eagle 2, high over the Atlantic, the aeronauts are climbing to an altitude which requires oxygen for the first time.
No, I think I can twist
it. Here, okay, just pull this off and untwist this.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
You got it?
We're clear otherwise?
Yeah, go ahead. Still too tight?
No, too tight.
Okay, yours okay, Ben?
Yeah. Let me hook up the camera. Hook up the phone. Hey, we're going to be on a map. I think what we all ought to do is get used to breathing just very normal. Conserve the oxygen. My sunglasses won't go on there. This doesn't work too well either.
A crucial decision is made to keep going higher and higher to avoid a storm coming behind them. They have to climb above 21,000 feet.
It's 10 o'clock.
We should let that rain in. Well, Ben, the only way we're going to let it in, it'd work against us unless we can get it out.
Or catch it in the bucket.
In the bucket?
What they get instead of the storm is water from the melting ice on the balloon.
Have you noticed that as soon as you take your oxygen mask off, you're busy yet?
Yeah, I'm busy.
I'm not fighting it too much right now. Maxie, what's the highest you ever flew through?
I think they were 15, didn't I?
I think so. Well, yeah, on that bike's peak race.
Yeah.
Well, how high did we go when we flew your hot air balloon, man? That day that I went up with you and you scared the hell out of me? 10? But then this is called getting up there.
Look, it's Buster Bones.
I want a meaty tasting dog food now.
Meaty taste? Gravy Train's got it in the bag.
Come on, try dog food with meaty taste.
Just try Gravy Train. Wet or dry, every chunk has protein and natural meaty taste.
Dinah, this Gravy Train's really meaty tasting.
It turns you into a pussycat.
Gaines Gravy Train. We've got meaty taste in the bag.
What kind of drumstick is this?
There's a new snack cracker, looks like a drumstick. Tastes so good, you lick your lips.
Dixie's, Dixie's drumstick snack crackers.
New Dixie's from Nabisco, the snack cracker shaped like a drumstick with a fried chicken paste that's lip-licking good.
Dixie's, Dixie's.
New Dixie's
drumstick snack crackers.
By Nabisco.
Sunday, September 17th, Battlestar Galactica arrives. The greatest space spectacular ever filmed in its motion picture premiere. Somewhere beyond our galaxy, a civilization fights to survive.
Most of us are dead.
Join Commander Adama, Captain Apollo, Lieutenant Starbuck, and the dazzling Athena on their quest for a new world aboard Battlestar Galactica.
'78. The flight of Double Eagle 2 will continue in a moment.
Pennant race action heats up Monday night on ABC.
I drink Dr. Pepper and I'm proud. I'm part of an original crowd.
And if you look around these days, there seems to be a Dr. Pepper craze. I'm a pepper, he's a pepper, she's a pepper, we're a pepper, wouldn't you like to be a pepper too? I'm a pepper, he's a pepper, she's a pepper, if you drink Dr. Pepper, you're a pepper too. Be a pepper, drink Dr. Pepper, be a pepper.
Channel 24, your Summer Place 78.
In Albuquerque, Ben Abruzzo is a land developer and owner of Sandia Peak Ski Resort. Championship balloonist, aircraft pilot, avid sportsman. He often hang glides down to his home at the base of the mountain.
Ben, in addition to ballooning, you've done some hang gliding off the top of this mountain.
I've flown about 70 times from the top of the city.
Have you had any unusual experiences coming up?
Well, one day I was spiraling down this big canyon back above the house here, and it was such a beautiful flight with the air so smooth that you felt like you were really just suspended. And I lost track of what I was doing, and I spiraled down, and the last spiral, I spiraled right into my neighbor's house. And crashed into the side of his house. Destroyed the hang glider completely, broke it into many, many pieces, nothing at all left of it. The sail was all torn, and I was in his flower garden. He came out on the porch, he looked down, and he said, "Where'd you come from?" I said, "I've had a slight accident."
Well, Ben, you're 48 years old. Now, why do you do all of these things?
I suppose it's just the challenge and the uniqueness of this kind of an adventure. We've tried about everything there is to try. Scuba diving, sailing. Just, I feel as though a person ought to, if he feels like he should, have a go at most everything that there is to try.
Also in Albuquerque, Maxie Anderson owns a copper and uranium mining firm. He and Ben have ballooned together for years. I asked him what he learned most from their previous attempt to cross the Atlantic.
But you must first predetermine that you're going to make it and how you're going to make it. And now we have enough information and enough knowledge of things which aren't supposed to happen to balloons and balloonists, that, and we've survived them, and we've learned how to deal with them, and we have learned how to fly the weather better. And I believe that combination will be invaluable to us on the next takeoff.
What are the odds?
18-1.
At 31, Larry Newman builds hang gliders and owns one of the largest hang gliding manufacturing companies in the world. He started flying at a young age, graduating to corporate jets. He's a newcomer to ballooning, but his navigational skills are strong. Flying hang gliders, he has few equals. And oh, the thought of gliding down thousands of feet from the Double Eagle II and the dream of touching down across the ocean on European soil. It's now Monday morning, and the balloon is sailing on course over the Atlantic, flying at some 15,000 feet. Keeping track of the Double Eagle II are meteorologists at Weather Services Corporation in Bedford, Massachusetts. Among them, Peter Levitt.
I suspect if you just launched a constant level balloon, that is a balloon that could fly at a particular level without any capability of going up or down, the odds are probably only 1 in 100 that it would get to Europe.
The wives are also on hand watching the progress of the flight. Chief meteorologist Bob Rice helps to make some of the important decisions as the weather and the wind keep changing. On Monday, a weather problem has developed.
I don't think this is necessarily permanently bad. No, we still feel that it's going to crush that ridge and start turning back to the east again. The ultimate failure route, let's put it that way, would be probably right up towards southern Greenland. And in as much as they've already visited that area, I think we'd probably like to have something else.
0.6.
It's Tuesday and 4 days into the flight.
This year, however, we're happy to say at this point we've resolved this problem in that we're not making a left turn. We're proceeding on a almost ideal course for the continent. And instead of starting to worry about scheduling a rescue operation at this point, we're planning to ship the wives, have the wives fly on to Europe. And
the next morning, the balloonist wives are on their way to London. The prospect of the balloon reaching Ireland sometime that night becomes more real at every moment. On the way, the wives fly close enough to see the balloon and talk to their husbands. At this moment, the balloon is on its last big push for the Irish coast and victory.
few minutes each day, and that's when they've been able to talk to them. Yes, I said, we're flying right over you. And he said, I know, I can see the plane. Isn't that exciting? Ah. Oh, it was.
I told Ben that we knew they could do it, and he said, now, he said, we've got a little piece to go yet.
Sergeant Carrad will need one of those for the aircraft. Okay, we have a...
The Air Force prepares for an overwater navigation training flight, and they allowed us to join them. There is still the danger of the balloon getting pushed way off course, the way it happened last time, when freezing, swirling wind dashed their hopes and almost their lives off Iceland.
Charlie, be kind of tight. What I suggest you do is, unless we get close to the balloon, you know, let's just move everybody forward that you can. And you just control the movement back there.
Okay, the balloon will be coming up on the right side. 10,000 feet close.
And Double Eagle, this is King 50. For your information, the present way you've been tracking for the past few hours will take you into the Irish coast between Shannon and Limerick.
Double Eagle, this is Bobby Eddie. Can you hear me?
No, this is Double Eagle. This is Ben.
Ben, it's nice to talk to you. How's everything going up here?
Well, considering everything, actually quite well. It's a little cold. It's got a long way to go. But now let's go through tonight. And we land tomorrow with reasonable ballast. If we make our destination, should be okay. If we don't, we land in the sea.
Well, everything looks positive from where we sit. We're hoping we're going to see an island someplace.
The gondola is being stripped now. And when we ballast off tonight, we'll be down to just bare essentials to go through the night.
We had a report earlier, a couple of days ago, that you picked up quite a bit of ice.
Picked up about 300 pounds of ice, night before last.
The forecasts are pretty good right now. If they hold up the way they are, you should be able to make it right to France.
When we come in the land, we're going to come in from very high because we can't limit the altitude of the balloon too much. And we'll try for England or France if these high speed winds stay on, but probably be England.
And Double Eagle, this is Aircraft Commander on King 50. We're going to be departing the area shortly. Before we go, we'll give you one last good fix, and we're going to wish you a lot of luck.
This man, continue to monitor our position closely. Tonight when we ballast off by life raft.
You might be ditching and requiring rescue coverage for later on.
We'll be keeping our fingers crossed, guys. So will everybody else.
Well, thank you very much. We can use all the encouragement we can get.
As the sun sets, the flight of a pair of British balloonists only 2 weeks ago is most certainly weighing on their minds. Donald Cameron and Christopher Davy left from Newfoundland, making it nearly all the way across the Atlantic when a tear in their balloon began to bring them down. In a heartbreaking conclusion to what looked like sure victory, they were forced to plunge into the ocean just 117 miles from the coast of France.
Great shampoo.
Really clean.
Looks full.
Holds my set.
New beer-enriched Body on Tap shampoo.
Gives your hair super body.
Super hold.
Brewed with 1/3 real beer.
Wow.
But don't drink it.
Just shampoo. Whether I blow it.
Roll it.
Brush it.
Style it.
Sure feels full.
Really holds my set.
It's the beer shampoo that does it. New Body on Tap in 3 bodybuilding formulas.
That's body. On tap.
First 100 years, all we brought out of this mine was Levi's blue jeans. Tough as nails. But then we struck a whole new vein. Now look, new fabrics, new colors, and new styles. They all come from the same place as those blue jeans, so they're bound to do right by folks. Because here at Levi's, we put a little blue jean in everything we make.
Friday, September 1st. It's Christy and Jimmy McNichol with a preview of ABC's Great News Saturday Morning. With 8 is Enough's Adam Rich, Haywood Nelson and Danielle Spencer from What's Happening. Joey Travolta, Happy Days' Donnie Most, Donny Osmond, and the Pink Panther. Find out why
ABC's All-Star Saturday is where it's at.
Drifting toward the coast of Ireland, the Double Eagle 2 hits a cold mass of air that caused the balloon to plummet down to 4,000 feet. But now they're back up to 17,000 feet.
Double Eagle 2, this is Bob Beatty. Things look like they're going great. What's the plan from here on? What's the plan from here on?
We're going to Ireland, and if we make it as you forecast, we'll overfly Ireland and go for England.
Have you had any recent troubles?
Well, today we came down from 24.5 to 4,500 before we got it stopped. We were in a cold snake or some unusual atmospheric condition which caused us to lose 20,000 feet in a relatively short period of time.
How did you end up getting rid of ballast to get back up again?
We didn't. We superheated after the sun passed overhead and got an angle on the black of the balloon, and we superheated back up to 24 again.
What's the status of the hang glider?
The hang glider will go on one of the passes.
Here goes the glider.
It's a sad moment for Larry Newman. To maintain altitude, the glider has to go. One dream glides away in order to save the big one.
Okay, you're approximately 60 to 55 miles from success. What kind of land are you going to look for?
We will determine if we can land before about 9 o'clock tomorrow night in England. If we can, we'll seriously consider that.
Okay, we're going to stay with you. I'm going to turn you over to Don Sellers, our pilot right now.
Now the evening of Wednesday, August 16th. The balloonists are almost holding their breath. In our own aircraft, we watch along with them, hoping to see at any moment the dim outline of the Irish coast. They've come farther now than any other balloonists in history. Will the wind hold up in the night? No one dares ask it aloud. And gradually, like an apparition, Ireland begins to come into focus. At 10.02 p.m., one of the most elusive of mankind's endeavors is being achieved.
Let me be the first to congratulate you. You've done what nobody else has ever done in history. You've made it! And everybody here shares the enthusiasm with you. We're glad we could be with you for these last... How many days has it been? How does it all feel?
This is from Memphis to everyone in the United States. We brought the big one home for you across the Atlantic in a balloon.
Okay, Maxie?
Go ahead, Bob.
This sure makes a little bit, makes up for last year, doesn't it?
About 10,000% better, as a matter of fact, and they're so elated that it's onward in the darkness over Ireland. By the next morning, Double Eagle 2 has crossed Ireland, now passing over Wales and heading toward the Bristol Channel. Their altitude is dangerously low here. And now another decision. If they drop into the water here, or next in the English Channel, their accomplishment by their own and ballooning standards will be compromised. And yet they go on at the mercy of the winds, still too low over southern England. And they head for the Isle of Wight in the English Channel and on towards France. With almost every shred of ballast now gone, sleeping bags, food, most of the radio gear, heading toward Le Havre, France, three brave men who left on a dark night in Maine ride into the history books while the world watches and waits far below the clouds. Over the English Channel, the balloonists' wives wait for their first glimpse of the balloon on this side of the ocean, and to hear their husbands' voices again.
Where?
Oh,
woo! Woo!
exciting. I can hardly stand it. It's just beautiful, and we're so excited, and we're so proud of you. It's really too much.
Up, straight up.
The wives landed an airfield on the coast of France to watch the balloon come overhead in victory.
It's way up in the air. Look at it. It's just a little silver dot.
It is.
Oh, I see it.
The Double Eagle 2 comes closer to an almost unthinkable goal, landing at Le Bourget Airport outside Paris, where Lindbergh touched down in the spirit of St. Louis 51 years ago. We flew out to meet them as they arrived over France.
Are you pretty tired? Maxie?
Maxie, how do you bring down a helium balloon? Does that present any difficult problems?
Being single, I've had to learn to take care of myself, and I've also had to learn to take care of my car, and I bring it to Sears because I trust them.
We're at a Sears store to find out why Sears is where America shops.
Oh, I love their carpet. They said they'd be out a certain day. Sears was out that day. They took care of everything from putting it down to making sure it was all tucked in the corners. It was just looked gorgeous.
I love it because you get what you want at a good price.
Sears, where America shops.
Ballpoint pens are such a drag, a tiresome affair.
Never fear, Quicksilver's here.
Scoring to the point for flair.
Introducing new Quicksilver Flair. It's got a smoother ball than ordinary ballpoints and famous flair ink, so writing flows smoothly and looks brilliant. Now you've got Quicksilver.
Ballpoints can't compare.
It's smooth and quick, a whole new kick.
Scoring to the point for flair.
Quicksilver Flair. Ballpoints can't compare.
In their sixth day, now over France, the three balloonists fly the American Stars and Stripes and the French tricolors, cruising downward in quiet triumph. It's late in the afternoon. They keep on toward Le Bourget, losing altitude faster and faster. The sun begins to set behind them. Le Bourget is still more than 60 miles ahead. The decision has been made to land. They approach the town of Evreux, just 50 miles short of Lindbergh's landing site. And as they pass over the town itself, the touchdown is close at hand. The last of the sand goes over as they cross Route Nationale 13. Outside the tiny village of Miseray, France, after flying 3,120 miles for 137 hours and 7 minutes, a farmer's field becomes a landmark for all time. Running out to the field as if from nowhere, to see them, to help them, to touch them. And cars have been tracking the balloon from back roads and highways. More than 5,000 people suddenly racing to greet them in a scene reminiscent of Lindbergh's landing in 1927. The crush of admirers and well-wishers is an incredible experience.
Hey, buddy! Hey, Bob! We did it!
Missing Le Bourget by such a short distance of 50 miles.
We didn't really think we could make it, but we decided that it would be an interesting little extra side venture. So we just made that another goal after flying across the ocean. What's another country?
Maxie Anderson has broken out the traditional bottle of champagne that they carried aboard for the landing.
Boy, this is a thrill, isn't it?
Yeah, I think I'm going to owe a farmer some money for his crop.
I think we all are with all these helicopters coming in.
Yeah.
What's going to happen tonight?
Well, I think I'll work on getting drunk.
That shouldn't be very hard.
I'm going to sleep a lot.
The cry of Le Ballon, Le Formidable, is suddenly broadcast around the world from this incredible scene in the countryside of France. From this time forth, there will be no other balloonist to make the first crossing of the Atlantic. A record that cannot be broken. The flight is over, but the celebration has just begun.
You're feeling good about yourself. The way you should about yourself.
You look good, you feel good, and it shows. You're drinking one-calorie diet Pepsi-Cola, the taste that's changing the taste of America.
And you're drinking Diet Pepsi.
When I was a kid, I was a real tomboy, and I still love the outdoor life. But there's a side of me that wants to be very soft and pretty, especially my hair. That's why I like Nice and Easy. It gives me fabulous highlights. It's got the conditioners I need, and the color looks so natural. It lets me be me. I guess that's why Nice and Easy is the world's best-selling hair color.
ABC Sports Special, John Denver in Alaska, an American child, next Sunday night.
You feel like you have made history?
Well, I don't guess you really think of it that way. You're glad if you did, but you're really trying to accomplish something that you know is hard, and it is.
Max, have some wine.
The youngest member of your trip wanted to land in Europe on a hang glider. Are you disappointed that didn't happen?
A little bit, yes, but after being in the balloon for four or five days, I started really feeling like a balloonist instead of a hang glider pilot, so it wasn't so bad.
And do you have a real sense that you've made history?
No. I know it's never been done before, but you get so involved in what you're doing that the idea of making history doesn't seem that important.
How do you feel?
Well, I feel like I just flew from the United States to France in a balloon.
At the American Embassy in Paris, another crowd waits.
They come from Albuquerque, right? Well, I come from Albuquerque.
Oh. The Lido dancers aren't the only ones waiting.
It's impossible.
How do you feel?
Well, delighted.
We feel delighted. We're a little bit relaxed and a little more comfortable than we've been for the last 6 days.
Why did you sit down at Influ?
Sunset was coming. We had no choice. We were out of ballast. It was time to land. Mm-hmm. We're only slightly disappointed. It's only 50 miles short of our goal, but we did cover 3,000 miles or so. We set the world record for endurance. It's the world record for distance, and we're the first to cross the Atlantic in a balloon. So, therefore, the disappointment had to be very, very slight.
Finally, a reunion with their wives for the first time since landing. Paris seems to be in a frenzy of goodwill and excitement. The Americans have hardly had enough time to realize the impact they've had both here and across the globe. Most on their minds, even now, is the very personal satisfaction of having achieved what they set out to do. They've been invited by the American ambassador to spend the night at the embassy. A fitting end to this historic day and night, when three men proved, once again, that the most individual achievements are also the most universal. It began almost unnoticed by the rest of the world in an obscure clover field in Maine. It was a test of human ingenuity and courage in the face of a vast transatlantic voyage. It was not a practical way to cross the ocean, at least not in this day and age. It was mostly three men against the wind and the cold and their own endurance. It was a dream they turned into something so real that people were drawn toward them by a common bond. It was the same force that Lindbergh ignited in the crowds of his day. A feeling that we all share, young and old, breaking down the boundaries between us. What it was really was an inspiration to give the best that we have, to try, and sometimes with luck, to do the impossible. Ben Abruzzo. It was Maxie Anderson. And Larry Newman. And now their victory has become our own, and for the generations to come.
Navigate the globe.
We'll take lots of goodies.